Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. In this module, we shall be studying about isotope geology. You know that the concept of radioactivity was given somewhere in 1896 by Henry Becquerel. And since the discovery of radioactivity, it has been found that the radioactive materials are having number of applications. In the radioactivity, there is a term called as isotope. So, today we will be discussing about isotopes in detail. The objectives of this module are to understand that how different type of isotopes are formed. Second objective of this module is to understand the isotope fractionation processes and its implications. And third one is to how to analyze and report the isotope data. And fourth objective of this module is applications of isotopes in solving geological and environmental problems. Let me tell you one thing here, that isotopes can be used for quantitative analysis as well as for the treatment. At both places these can be used. So, before we move further, let me try to know that what are isotopes. Isotopes are defined as atoms of same element having the same number of electrons and protons, but contains different number of neutrons, thereby having same atomic number but different atomic mass. For example, hydrogen is having three isotopes. One is called as hydrogen, second is called as deuterium, third one is called as tritium. In every one, in all the three, hydrogen, deuterium and tritium, there is one electron and one proton, but in the first one there is no neutron, in second one there is a neutron, and in third one there are two neutrons. Similarly, you know that natural uranium is having three isotopes: uranium-235, uranium-233, and uranium-238. These are the three different isotopes. All the three are having same atomic number, that is 92. So now the question arises: how formation of elements take place? Formation of elements take place in stars and in supernova by of nucleosynthesis processes. Some light elements like hydrogen and its isotopes, as I already told you, deuterium, helium and lithium, were created during the Big Bang. Elements with atomic masses up to iron are produced in stars in response to a number of reactions over a range of temperatures. Rest of the elements which are heavier than iron are formed during supernova explosion. In this, this figure shows the formation of elements in stars. You will find in this figure that hydrogen burns in the core of a star to form helium, which in turn burns to produce carbon and oxygen. When hydrogen is exhausted, the star contracts and the temperature rises to the tune of 10^8 K Kelvin. This is the stage when nuclear reactions start to produce all other elements up to the atomic mass of iron. Now, let me have a look on this table. This table is showing range of temperatures of formation of elements in stars. This table is having three columns. In the first, the temperature is given. In the second one, the burning and fusion name of burning and fusion element is given. And in third, as a result of burning and fusion, which elements are produced. Okay. And you will find in the first row, the temperature has been presented in the range of 10^6 Kelvin. So, when the temperature is 1 to 60 into 10^6 Kelvin, that time burning or fusion of hydrogen take place, and that leads to the production of helium. Similarly, when temperature is 200 into 10^6 Kelvin, that time burning of helium take place, and that leads to production of carbon and oxygen. When temperature is in the range of 800 into 10^6 Kelvin, that time burning or fusion of carbon take place, and that leads to formation of oxygen, neon, sodium, magnesium. Similarly, at 1500 into 10 raised to power 6 Kelvin, burning or fusion of oxygen take place that leads to production of different elements from magnesium to sulfur. And when temperature is in the range of 3000 into 10 raised to power 6 Kelvin, that time burning of magnesium to sulfur take place and other elements which are close to iron are produced. Now, there are several classes of isotopes. We will be discussing the different classes of isotopes. Based on their formation or application, isotopes can be categorized into several classes, and these classes include primordial isotopes, cosmogenic isotopes, anthropogenic isotopes, radiogenic isotopes, stable isotopes, and non-traditional isotopes. Now, we will try to learn about what is the meaning of these different types of isotopes. Let me first take primordial isotopes. Primordial isotopes are formed before the, were formed rather, primordial isotopes were formed before the formation of Earth. Primordial isotopes were formed by nucleosynthesis in Big Bang and subsequent to it in starch, and were present in the interstellar medium from which the solar system was formed. Some examples of primordial isotopes include xenon-136, osmium-186, barium-130, potassium-40, uranium-238, uranium-235. These all come under the category of primordial isotope. Then cosmogenic isotopes. Cosmogenic isotopes form constantly in the Earth's atmosphere or on the exposed surface of the Earth by interaction of cosmic rays and target element. The examples of this are beryllium-10, C-14, tritium, sulfur-35, argon-39, beryllium-7, iodine-129, chlorine-39. These all are examples of this category. Then anthropogenic isotopes. As the name indicating, anthropogenic isotopes are generated through various activities of man, including nuclear reactions in the nuclear reactors or nuclear weapon explosions. Some example of these are polonium-239, polonium-240, C-14, tritium, iodine-129, chlorine-36. I will give one assignment to my students. Please have a look upon different power plants of India and try to, in all the power plants of India, natural uranium is used as fuel, means isotope 235 of the natural uranium is used as fuel. Now, when fission of this uranium 235 take place, several daughter nuclei isotopes are produced. So, please make a list of the different isotopes which are produced due to the fission of uranium-235 that is used as fuel in the nuclear reactors. Then next is the radiogenic isotopes. Radiogenic isotopes form as a product of radioactive decay. You might be knowing that in nature, three radioactivity decay chains are going on. One start with the thorium-232, second start with the uranium-238, third start with uranium-235. Now, these all ultimately ends into lead. So, during this decay process, coming up to the lead from the starting point, a number of intermediates are produced. So, they all come in this category, and the examples are americium-147, C-14, uranium-238, uranium-235, uranium-234, then radium-226, etc. Stable isotopes. Stable isotopes are not product of radioactive decay. They don't naturally decay, but can exist in natural materials in different proportions. Examples are deuterium, hydrogen, this C-12, C-13, oxygen, sulfur-32, sulfur-34, nitrogen-15, nitrogen-14, etc. Then non-traditional isotopes. Non-traditional isotopes are stable isotopes in addition to traditional stable isotopes. Non-traditional isotopes include isotopes of calcium, copper, iron, chromium, molybdenum, magnesium, zinc, etc. Now, a question arises before us that what is the importance of isotopes, whether these are of some use or not. Isotopes have emerged as an essential tool for understanding many earth processes, particularly in environmental science and geology. These are extensively being used in understanding physical, chemical and biological processes in contamination studies, atmospheric sciences, climate studies, exploration geochemistry, biogeochemistry, resource management, ecology, microbial activity, geochemical cycles, ocean studies, etc. So, we can say in nutshell that isotopes are having applications in almost every field. So, isotopes have also been used to obtain age and rate of processes. The non-traditional isotopes have been extensively employed to evolve sustainable strategies in pollution studies involving multiple sources, both anthropogenic and natural. Now, the question arises that how to do the measurement of isotopes. Based on different properties of isotopes, actual purpose of study, half-life of the radioactive isotope, abundance of isotope available in the material to be analyzed, and ratio of stable isotope to the element, different techniques are used to measure the isotopes. So, we can say which technique will be used, that will depend upon the concentration and properties, half-life, etc. of the radioisotopes. All measurement techniques of isotopes revolve around two fundamental different approaches. One of them is counting method and second one is the mass spectrometry. Now, what are these methods? Let first we discuss counting method. Counting methods are designed to detect alpha, beta and gamma radiations. You know that when decay of these radionuclides take place, that time energy is emitted either in the form of alpha, beta or gamma. These techniques in which we detect alpha, beta and gamma radiation, they are known as alpha spectrometry, beta spectrometry and gamma spectrometry. Means when we will be detecting the alpha, then it will be called as alpha spectrometry. Then mass spectrometry methods. Mass spectrometry method are designed to count the isotopes directly. Before counting the isotopes, the separation of isotopes is achieved by allowing the charged particles to pass through a magnetic field, whereby the isotopes are as per their mass to charge ratio are separated. Here the line diagram of a mass spectrometer is shown that is used or that is showing the separation of masses M1, M2 and M3. Please have a look upon mass spectrometry. You will find the notes of mass spectroscopy in paper number 2 of this EPG Pathshala program on environmental sciences. So, please have a look over there. Yes, this figure shows separation of different masses of an element E through mass spectrometer. In the mass spectrometer, the different elements are separated on the basis of mass to charge ratio, and in this case we get this kind of spectra. Okay, now let me discuss common mass spectrometric techniques. Include thermal ionization mass spectrometry, inductively coupled plasma source mass spectrometry, gas source mass spectrometry. This includes isotope ratio mass spectrometry, then accelerator mass spectrometry, secondary ion mass spectrometry. So, these are the different type of mass spectrometries. Now, how to report the isotopic data? This is very, very important for us. The absolute concentration of isotopes and also the difference between two isotopes of an element is generally too small to measure with adequate precision. So, it is convenient to use a ratio while reporting the isotopic data. By comparing the ratio of the sample to to that of a standard, the difference between the two can be determined much more precisely. Now, reporting isotopic data, stable isotopes conventionally, the stable isotope ratio of any element is reported in comparison to a standard. Since the variations in isotopic ratios are small, delta, this notion is generally used where D is defined as DHE is equal to R sample divided by R standard minus 1 multiplied by 1000, where R is equal to heavy to light isotope ratio of element E, for example, D oxygen 18 is equal to oxygen 18 divided by oxygen 16. So, here the heavier nuclei is divided by the lighter nuclei, sample divided by oxygen 18 divided by oxygen 16 standard minus 1 into 1000. Reporting isotopic data, radiogenic isotopes. For radiogenic isotope, it is convenient to report isotopic ratios by dividing a stable isotope which is not produced by radioactive decay and hence remains constant through time. For example, lead 206 divided by lead 204. Lead 206 is a radiogenic stable isotope, whereas lead 204 is a stable isotope that is not produced by radioactive decay. Then radiogenic isotopes age determination. The basic use of radiogenic isotopes has been in age determination, which makes use of the constancy of the rate of radioactive decay. Since a radioactive nucleide decays to its daughter at a constant rate, which is not dependent on anything, age can be determined by measuring how much of the nucleide has decayed. Age determination. The basic law of radioactive decay is that rate of decay of radioactive nuclei is proportional to the amount of the parent isotope, here we will be writing it as n, and is expressed as dn by dt, that is equal to lambda n, where lambda is the decay constant. This equation can further be written as n is equal to n0 e raised to power minus lambda t, where n0 is the number of nuclei present at time t is equal to 0 and n is the number of nuclei present at time t. This equation can further be modified to reach to a situation where the parameters are measured, and that equation is shown here. Let me show you a diagram. This diagram depicts decay of radionuclide to a stable radiogenic daughter through time. Here lambda is decay constant, n0 is the number of parent isotope, and d is the number of daughter isotopes present at time t. You will find that in the beginning n0 is maximum, but with the time n0 decreases due to the decay. On the other hand, you will find in the beginning when t is equal to 0, the number of daughters at time t is 0, but slowly because of decay the number of daughters increases. So, in the decay process we can say the number of radioactive isotope will decrease with time and the number of daughters will increase with time. Now, how much time will be taken, that will depend on the half life period of that particular isotope. The half life period of the different isotopes is highly variable. For some of the radio isotopes this is, you can say, in milliseconds, and whereas for some of the radioactive elements this is in millions of years. This is highly variable depending upon the properties of the isotope. Whenever we do isotopic studies, we need some standard reference materials. So, the standard reference materials are used in isotopic studies. the absolute isotopic concentration of any given element are too small to measure and compare them accurately. Conventionally, isotopic ratio of any given element are compared to standard values for that element. By comparing the ratio of a sample to that of a standard, the difference between these two can be determined much more precisely. Now, the question arises where from we can get these standard reference materials. There are several international agencies from where these standard reference materials can be obtained. So, here I am giving you the names of some of the labs from where these can be obtained. One of them is VSMOW, that is Vienna Standard Mean Ocean Water. This is mainly used as standard reference material for hydrogen and oxygen isotopes. PDB, that is PD belnamite, fossil of belnamite from the PD formation in Canada. These are used for carbon and oxygen isotope. CDT, cation diblotroilite meteorolite fragment containing FeS mineral, troilite used for sulfur isotope. AIR, this is atmospheric air that is used for nitrogen isotope, means different materials are used as standard for different radio isotopes. Now, let we come to isotopic fractionation. Differences in mass arising out of different number of neutrons may affect the kinetics of physical, may affect the kinetics of physical, biological and chemical reactions involving different isotopes. Mainly for lighter isotopes whose mass is less than 40, that leads to substantial differences in isotopic ratios of the element. Such partitioning or sorting of isotope is termed as isotopic fractionation. Molecules react with different rates depending on their different masses because of different isotopic composition. This enables all chemical, physical and biological processes fractionate isotopes. Mass differences give rise to isotopic fractionation during physical processes. Example of the physical processes are evaporation, condensation, freezing, diffusion, etc. This figure shows the fractionation of isotopes. Here we have shown the fractionation of oxygen isotopes in water and vapor phase. So, please have a look and try to understand that how the fractionation of isotopes take place in nature. Now, let me discuss some general facts about isotope fractionation. Molecules with lighter isotopes diffuse faster and evaporate faster, form weaker bonds, react faster and concentrate in products. Biological processes prefer lighter isotopes in the product. Higher oxidation state is preferred by heavier isotopes. Solid phases and compounds with the strongest bonds are preferred by heavier isotopes. Now, what is the mechanism of or of fractionation of isotopes? There are two mechanisms by which isotope fractionation take place. One of them is equilibrium isotope fractionation and second one is kinetic isotope fractionation. Let me try to understand both the fractionation mechanisms. In equilibrium isotope fractionation, driving force is the differences in the vibrational energy of the molecules containing different isotopes. In kinetic isotope fractionation, this type of fractionation is transient, occur in undirectional way, that is open system, non-equilibrium and incomplete, and is very effective mechanism for isotope fractionation. This is mainly driven by differences of kinetics of molecules containing different masses. Here in this formula, alpha represents the fractionation factor, that is equal to R reactant divided by R product. And here we have shown one example that alpha oxygen 18 is equal to oxygen 18 divided by oxygen 16 in liquid phase, that is water, divided by oxygen 18 divided by oxygen 16 in the vapor phase, where R is the ratio of heavy to lighter isotope. So, by this equation or by this formula, we can calculate the fractionation factor. Let me discuss the applications of isotopes in detail. Isotopes can reveal information about the age, genesis and processes involved in the origin and evolution. Stable isotopes are used in assessing relative contribution of various reservoirs, each with a distinctive isotopic signature. Radiogenic isotopes provide useful information regarding the age and origin of earth and earth materials. Radiogenic isotopes are useful to understand petrogenetic processes, as the heavy radiogenic isotope ratios are not usually fractionated by physical or chemical processes. Based on isotopic ratios, different mental geochemical components with distinct isotopic signatures have been delineated. Isotopes are very important in understanding the processes like characterization of source, mixing processes, physical and chemical processes, and above all age determination. Now, let me discuss the application of isotopes in environmental science field. In environmental studies, most of the early development isotopic methods were focused on solving bedrock and core geological problems, mainly concerned with providing absolute age and understanding the earth processes. More recently, isotope geology has emerged central to environmental studies in providing powerful tracers, rate monitors and fingerprints for processes in terrestrial, surface and near surface, atmospheric, ecological and aquatic environment. Or in nutshell, we can say that isotopes are widely used in environmental studies, and the isotopes which are used in environmental studies, they include stable isotope, cosmogenic isotopes, radiogenic isotopes and anthropogenic isotopes. Let me discuss the application of these different type of isotopes in environmental sciences. Let first we discuss stable isotope applications. Most commonly used stable isotopes for environment in the field of environmental sciences are oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, carbon, sulfur, lithium, boron, etc. I'll suggest my students, let them find out the different isotopes and make a listing of their applications in the field of environmental sciences. Common fractionation of isotopes of these elements are kinetic processes, equilibrium partitioning and biological processes. Oxygen and hydrogen isotopes have successfully been utilized to lineate juvenile, meteoric and brine water. It has been observed that climatic temperature declined from 700 C during Eratian time to 30 to 200 C in Paleozoic time in the geological past. It has also been revealed from the study of oxygen isotopes of benthic foraminifera that continental ice sheet in the Antarctica formed during Miocene era. Other common examples of applications of stable isotopes have been in the field of groundwater, atmospheric sciences, weathering, hydrocarbon exploration, pollution studies, etc. Recently, I visited a plant over there that was a sewage treatment plant. In the sewage treatment plant, ultimately the sludge is generated. And we all know that sludge is having very good manurial value and can be used as fertilizer in our agriculture field. But usually we don't use it because of presence of microbial or you can say pathogenic microorganisms in it. In that plant, I have seen that the sludge was exposed to the radiations, and because of this radiation all the microbes were killed and beautiful manure of excellent quality was prepared making the use of radiations given by different isotopes. So, please try to know the applications of isotopes or radiations in different fields like agriculture, health, storing, then you can say this treatment of medical equipments, etcetera. You will find it very interesting. Now, let us look for deuterium to hydrogen groundwater system. Identification and quantification of recharge, discharge and mixing processes, interrelationship between surface water and groundwater, flow and interconnections between aquifers, mechanism of pollution in arid and semi-arid conditions, isotope methods for groundwater studies are very effective. So, this deuterium to hydrogen ratio can be used for these groundwater studies. Similarly, oxygen 18 to oxygen 16 can be used in climatic studies, paleoclimate, study of oxygen isotopes from ice cores, shells of marine plants and animals. Spelotherms reveals past climatic conditions including temperature, rainfall. Oxygen isotopes also used in groundwater studies. Then sulfur 34 and sulfur 32. Sulfur source and cycling in atmosphere and environment. Stable sulfur isotope have been used to track movement of sulfur in groundwater, surface water bodies and atmosphere. Sulfur isotopes have also been employed to identify the natural and anthropogenic sources of sulfur in the environment. Now, let me come to the application of nitrogen 15 and nitrogen 14. Agriculture and groundwater investigations to trace natural and anthropogenic sources of nitrate, nitrogen cycling and to study marine ecosystem, we can use nitrogen 15 and nitrogen 14. Now, silicon 30 and silicon 28 applications. Effective fraction of silicon isotopes occurs during silica biomineralization, withering and also during clay formation. So, finds application in biological cycling of silicon and assessment of withering intensity of terrestrial rock. Now, boron 11 and boron 10. Groundwater studies for constraining distinct solute sources, particularly natural versus anthropogenic, identifying contaminants such as fly ash leachate in groundwater, seawater intrusion. So, in this type of studies, boron 11 and boron 10 studies can be used. Then applications of C13 and C12, carbon isotope ratio is in benthic foraminifera has been used as proxy for nutrient cycling, increasingly being used in marine ecosystem to differentiate sources of carbon at C3 and C4 plants. Then lithium 6 and lithium 7 applications as an environmental tracer to study withering processes used in groundwater studies to study adsorption of lithium in aquifer. Then let me come to the cosmogenic isotopes. Isotopes formed from reactions involving cosmic rays within atmosphere and also on the exposed surface are known as cosmogenic isotopes. These isotopes have been used as atmospheric and ocean circulation tracers and also in surface processes including geomorphological processes. Cosmogenic isotopes that have accumulated on or near the surface as a result of interaction between the cosmic ray and the target element can provide information on timing and rate of surface processes including geomorphic processes, fault displacement, burial of sediments, erosion events, etcetera. Now, let me have a look on the cosmogenic isotopes applications in environmental studies. C14 forms in the atmosphere and ultimately find its way to the plants and animals, and this C14 has extensively been used to obtain AZE's atmospheric and ocean circulation. You all might have studied carbon dating. In carbon dating, we use C14, and you all know that while using C14 carbon dating, we can find out the age of anything up to 50,000 years. Similarly, beryllium-10. Beryllium-10 is having application or involved in atmospheric circulation, removal of aerosols, sediment recycling in the mantle, dating of sedimentation, and growth rate of manganese nodules. Tritium is having applications in groundwater studies and dating of groundwater. Iodine-129 can again be used in groundwater studies as well as for the dating of groundwater. Now, let me come to the cosmogenic isotopes in environmental studies. Let me take the example of argon-39. Argon-39 is used in atmospheric circulation. Similarly, silicon-32 used or can be used in the cycling of silicon in the ocean atmospheric circulations. Sulfur-35 again can be used to study sulfur cycle. P-32 can be used for atmospheric circulations. Now, let me come to the applications of radiogenic isotopes. Radiogenic isotopes are particularly applied in two different ways. One is to obtain an absolute age, and second is to trace or track the origin of a component. Radiogenic isotope applications we are discussing. Long-lived isotopes employed to obtain ages of events in geological past, short-lived isotopes useful in obtaining relatively younger events processes. Strontium-87 and strontium-86, these can be used to identify the sources of lead-210, can be used as tracer in atmospheric study, can be used to determine the age of sediments and also rate of sedimentation. Similarly, isotopes of helium, iodine, argon, these behave in a conservative way and may enter in the groundwater and provide ideal tracers, making them very useful for groundwater studies. Now, let me come to the anthropogenic isotopes. As I told you earlier, that there are a number of isotopes which are produced by the man due to its two major activity. One of them is the nuclear power plants, and second one is the nuclear explosions. So, we can say these are generated in the nuclear reactors or during the nuclear bomb testing or explosions. These isotopes may act as contaminant in the environmental study. Most commonly used anthropogenic isotopes in environmental studies are C14, iodine-129, chlorine-36, tritium, and in case of power plants, you will find cesium-137, strontium-90, cobalt-60, tritium, etc. are under the category of anthropogenic isotopes. Conventionally, anthropogenic isotopes may be categorized in two groups. One are the radionuclides not otherwise present or produced in the nature. So, the example is cesium-137, Pu-240. Second are the radionuclides occurring as distinct pulses of otherwise naturally occurring isotopes. The example is C14. Use of nuclear bombs or atmospheric bombs testing in the 1950s produced a spike in the production of anthropogenic isotopes. These higher concentration can be used as marker also. So, anthropogenic isotopes have been mostly used in environmental studies. In this module, we have also learned what is fractionation of isotopes and how does isotope fractionation lead to varying isotope ratios. And we have discussed in detail application of different types of isotopes in solving geological, atmospheric, hydrogeological, climatic and environmental issues. I hope that you have enjoyed this module. Thank you.